just to get a normalization, I just want to know, are most of the people from 9th and 10th? Okay. So almost everybody knows radioactivity, right? You know Rutherford experiment? Very good. Okay, so the title that you people read out, that was read out, was Why Particle Physics Needs Big Experiments. The more formal title, which I didn't write there, but I'm writing here, is Why Fundamental Physics Needs Mega Projects. Why do I use the word mega projects? Because I think all of you have heard that this is a special exhibition to tell all of you the participation of India in what are called mega projects. Now, what is meant by mega? English word, everybody knows. Mega is just very big, right? So mega projects have a very specific meaning in the context of experiments. That is, these are not the projects which any one person, any one laboratory, any one institution, any one country can afford to do. Okay? That is because of the size, because of the money, because of the people, because of the expertise that is required. So there is a whole lot of class of projects where there is collaboration between a large number of countries, large number of scientists, and large number of people, young students like you, everybody works on this. Okay, so just to give an example, the one physics I know pretty well about is the physics of the colliders. And at CERN, for example, in a given experiment, on one given detector, 5,000 people are working together. And to build that machine, which we call Large Hadron Collider, it took 20 years and many thousands of engineers, many thousands of technicians. So a project like this is what we call mega projects. So what I want to tell you today is why does, you know, this sounds pretty difficult, right? So you would say, why am I doing all these things? Why don't I just sit in my office or in my own lab, and why don't I just do the experiments? The reason, of course, is, as you all I'm sure we know, one gives a price if what we are getting in return is worth the price, right? If you want to go and buy a television and somebody says, please pay 25,000 rupees, you'll say, okay, I'll pay it. But you won't pay the 25,000 rupees for a bicycle. So what you get in return is what you pay for. So here, why does the entire physics community, the world over, goes in, why does it go for mega projects? It goes for mega projects because right now, these are the kind of projects that we need to run to get answers to some very fundamental questions. And that is what I want to tell you, why the fundamental questions in physics right now seem to require these big projects. And I will give you examples only from particle physics, but at the end of it, I will come a little bit to astrophysics and astronomy. All right. So what I will do here, as you see, I'll give you a few facts about particle physics, because before I tell you why particle physics needs big projects, I should tell you what particle physics is all about. So that's why I will first tell you what particle physics is. Then I will give you a little tour down the memory lane, some of which was already began by very ably by Professor Vishwanath. And I will tell you how did we, what I mean by we, is the particle physics community, nuclear physics community, how did we arrive here? And then I will come to my major part of the talk, is how and why the discovery tools have changed in the journey. Okay? And that is the major part of my talk. And then I will try to tell you what are the questions about nature that still are not answered, and what devices do we need for them? Where do we go in future? And some of those future devices are upstairs in the exhibition where, luckily for us and proudly, India is participating. And then I want to end by us telling you that these complex tools are not just for answering these fundamental questions. Very often, they have some very real spin-off in our lives. So this is the plan of the talk. Let's see how far I go. So, you know, you will all agree that, you know, how do things around us work? See, even if you are talking not about science, even if you are talking in some, discussing some issue, you will say, what's the heart of the issue? What's the basic point that you want to understand so that you can understand the bigger picture? So the same way I can say, what is the heart of matter? There is matter all around us, but how do all the things around us work? And what are all things made up of? Actually, this question is not new. The question started from the beginning of times, and we will see when. But then the kind of questions are, is that if is everything around us made up of one single unit? If so, what is that unit? And why so? Why do these units make the big whole? This is an age-old question. And this question, so in shorter words, you know, somehow more colloquial words, you can say there is this edifice of life. Edifice is a big building, right? Everybody understands that word. So some big structure you make, now you only see the structure. You only go and see Taj Mahal. And then you ask a question, what are the bricks and what is the mortar? It is not enough to know what is a brick, what is the basic unit. It's also necessary to know how the brick is glued together by mortar. So you need to know what mortar have I used and what brick I have used. So what is this edifice of life that is all around us, the universe? What is the brick and the mortar of this structure that the universe is? And the question actually has remained the same through the ages. The answers have changed. And what is very interesting is that our perception as to what the parts are has changed as we have understood how the parts are glued together. Let me try to give you a better example in a few minutes, and then you will see this. So, if in fact, it will not be too much to say that the efforts to answer this question has actually led to the development of science in the centuries. It's not today, it's not yesterday, it's 2,000 years that this journey has been going on. And just to tell you how that journey is going on, if you were living in, you know, few hundred BC, okay? So the kind of people who would debate about this were the Greek philosophers. There was a very famous Greek philosopher, I don't know how many of you know the name, called Democritus. And then there is another famous Indian philosopher whose name some of you might know, called Kanada. And these people and many others postulated that everything around us is made up of five fundamental elements, and the Greeks thought four elements. Now the word element itself meant it was the part, it was the basic part, element, right? Now, the four elements according to the Greeks were earth, fire, wind, and water. And that's why in English we call them elements, right? Natural elements. That's our English usage. So they were considered the basic elements out of which everything was made. In fact, Democritus goes on to write that by convention there is color, by convention there is smell, but in reality there are only elements. Okay? So somehow things get put together and then things get properties. And how they are put together give them different properties. So if you make a cork, it will float on water. If you put a piece of anything, I don't know, piece of iron, down it will go. Unless you make it shape it very nicely, which is what Mr. Aristotle taught us. All right? So this is the point. Whereas Indian sages were a bit smarter, I think, because they said, along with these four, you also need space, akash. So if you were living in BC, these were the elements, and everything around us was made up of these five things. Luckily, we are not still in the BCs. So this basic idea, word, that element, actually by the time of Mendeleev, by the way, how many years has been since periodic table was put forward by Mendeleev? Anybody knows? This year, we are celebrating 100 years of periodic table. Okay? So 150 years ago, my mistake, 150 years ago, we got periodic table. Okay. So from the periodic table, so from elements we went to chemical elements, from chemical elements we went to molecules, by molecules we went to atoms, so on and so forth, till today, all of you know from reading newspapers, if nothing else, that actually the fundamental particles are something called quarks. I'm going to give a table later on, something called leptons. And more importantly, there are not only that there are only fundamental elemental particles, but there are also only four fundamental forces. Every force that we see is a manifestation of those fundamental forces. You will say, oh my God, that doesn't look correct. I know that the two molecules are not bound together by electromagnetic attraction. You say, no, but it's a derived force. Because it is the electron clouds from the two atoms which repel each other, and that's how sometimes attract each other, and the molecule gets held together. So the fundamental forces are only four. And those four fundamental forces are carried by four objects whom we happen to call bosons, because you can even call them bosons, I don't care, because I don't have the time to tell you the story. That is a different story, and that's not part of my story today. Anyway, so this is what we know. And what is even more important, which we will come only at the end of my talk, but which is very important, that what we study in these big experiments, in these big laboratories, at the Large Hadron Collider, or wherever you go, or at LIGO, whatever we study in these experiments, the important part is that the laws of physics that we study in these big experiments, now we find that in principle, all the laws of physics which govern the behavior of these elemental blocks actually allow us to predict behavior of matter everywhere. That means from first principles, I can tell you, it's not very accurate, but one can calculate why water boils at the temperature at which it boils. I hope you see the intellectual achievement in this, that in terms of these fundamental building blocks, and in terms of these fundamental forces, I can actually calculate on a computer and tell you that water must freeze at 4 degrees centigrade. That's an amazing feat, no? And that's the achievement of the last century, last one and a half century. All right. So what has happened is that in the development in human scientific understanding has told us that things are layers within layers within layers. It's like an onion structure. Okay, so, you people are no longer, when I was young, my mother used to have a big container of oil on her shelf. In that big container on the shelf, oil, there would be another picture where there will be a mother sitting and cooking, and in the picture, there will be another picture with another container of oil. I'm sure you have seen such advertisement pictures. So question is it just such a picture in a picture on a picture in a picture? Or is it like a Russian doll? How many people know what is a Russian doll? Russian doll is where you have layers inside, but at the end of it, there is nothing. So now we believe, particle physicists believe, that actually matter is something like this. And we think, and I will, some other day I can tell you why we think so, we think that we have actually opened the doll. It's in entirety, and all we have inside is space. And it is this picture that we arrived at starting from here. This we did in, this was few hundred BCs, and now we are in 2019, so some 2,000 years odd, okay, 2,500 years. The humanity has started from here and arrived here, okay? So this I will skip now, I don't have time. All right, so therefore, this is the story, this is my own picture, that in 1800s, people said matter exists in three states. Everybody knows that, right? Solid, liquid, gas. And what is the difference? The difference is only the state. Property, chemical property remains exactly the same. Water is H2O, whether it is solid ice or whether it is water or whether it is vapor. What is it? Vapor. Thank you. All right. So this is the first classification. But then what happened? People started realizing that, my God, I take a piece of metal, I heat it, and then what happens? electrons come out, no? Photoelectrons. Everybody has heard about it. If I heat it, there are thermoelectrons. If I put light on it and the electrons come out, they are photoelectrons. So somewhere people started realizing that, you know, there are these atoms, but they somehow separate themselves. You people have talked about Rutherford's experiment, so I'm jumping in view of time. But therefore, we go from molecules to atoms to nucleus plus electron. Then these electrons, finally we find that nucleus is also not a whole. It's not fundamental. It is made up of neutrons and protons. And the neutrons and protons are also not fundamental, but they are also made up of something further, which are called quarks. So the matter around us, and we ourselves and everything around us, the fundamental particles which we require to make up this matter are actually only two types of quarks, called up quark and down quark, and electrons. So up quark, down quark, and electron are prototypes of what I call quarks and leptons. Electron is one lepton, the earliest lepton that we came to know. All right? Now, what has happened here? Therefore, there was this molecule. The molecule was made up of atoms. Atom was made up of nucleus and electron. Nucleus was made up of neutrons and protons. Neutrons and protons were made up of quarks. And quarks are just hanging about. We are able to prove that as far as we can see, quarks are not made up of anything more. And what is the size of the quark? We can't quite measure it. But our experiments tell us that if at all there is a size to a quark, it's less than, it's a huge number, so fasten your seat belts, as one says, 10 to the minus 18 meters. What does that mean? You have to put 18 zeros. Okay, 0.18 zeros, 1. And a size of a quark is smaller than that. And in practice, we believe the quark has no size at all. So this is what has happened. And what is interesting is that you ask a question that for looking at structures of these sizes, what energy have I required? And that's why I gave you the example of thermal energy. How many people know something about thermal energy? The room temperature corresponds to how many EVs? Anybody knows? 8. I don't quite accept it. Heat, yes, correct. But I want to know room temperature. If you take room temperature, do you know what energy it corresponds to? Okay, if you don't, people know semiconductors? Semiconductors, everybody knows? Then what is the band gap in silicon? Anybody knows that? Okay. All right. So this is a few electron volts. Now, what is few electron volts? It's the energy that an electron gains when it falls through a potential difference of 1 volt. So you take a battery. If there are 8 volt potential difference across the two terminals of battery, an electron goes from one end to another, it will have gained 8 electron volts. So that's my basic unit of energy. And a thermal energy is actually 1 over 30 eV. So if you are at the heat, as somebody told me correctly, so point is that in atoms, the energy scale is about 10 eV, 100 eV, okay? So the energy scale of 10 to 100 eV and sizes of atoms, anybody have a simple idea? How many? It's angstroms. Sizes of atoms are angstroms. Sizes of nuclei are 5 degrees smaller than that. That's Fermi. Okay? So this is next. I will show you next slide where you see this a little bit better, even if you don't know the absolute numbers. So if this is one unit, then nucleus is 10,000 times smaller than that. This you can understand, no? Whether it's 1 meter or 10 to the minus 8 meter or 10 to the minus 13 meter, we forget that. What you see is that atom is 1,000 times, nucleus is 1,000 times smaller than an atom. A nucleon is another 10 times smaller than the nucleus. Nucleon is a proton or a neutron. It's clear, no? A nucleus which contains some large number of nuclei, nucleons, will be bigger than a single proton or a single neutron, and that's a difference of about size 10, factor 10. And all we know, as I told you, a quark is less than 9 zeros. All right? Now, the point is, as I go along lower and lower in size, people know about radioactive decay, right? You know about the alpha particles that Rutherford used. Do you know what is the energy of those alpha particles? Positive charge, yes. I'm asking you about, you have learned about nuclear physics? You have learned about binding energy of nuclei? You must have learned, no? No? Okay. So that is supposed to be a million electron volts. So from EV in the atomic binding energy, we go to million electron volts. So I go from this distance scale to this distance scale, which is five orders of magnitude lower, the energy has gone five orders of magnitude higher. That is the binding energy. Everybody is comfortable with the idea of binding energy? That the energy that I require to pull an electron out of an atom, I will call it a binding energy. If I want the energy to pull a nucleon, a proton or a neutron out of a nucleus, that's the binding energy of that proton or the neutron. Okay, that's what happens in radioactive decay. So what we see is that as I go shorter and shorter distance scales, the associated energies that are required to get that particle out are actually higher and higher. So there is this inverse relationship between the energies and the distances. Let's understand that a little bit better in half a second. But I want to show you that this is what our, so we begin with this, our atom, okay, here, our atom is 1 angstrom, our nucleus is about 10 Fermi, a proton or a neutron is about 1 Fermi. The same thing I have shown you here, 10,000, 100,000, and 1 million. And the same thing, now you ask yourself, we are talking of things at such small distances, huh? And where does it fit into the scheme of things? For example, how does it compare with the size of distance from here to sun? It's a huge distance, no? Now our Chandrayaan is going to moon, not even sun. And you know how long it's going to take, right? So you have a general idea that those distances are huge. Compared to this 10 to the minus 13 meters, 10 to the minus 9 meters, which we can't even measure directly. I cannot take a meter stick and measure them, right? So therefore, in the scheme of things, where do we sit? So this is the size of an entire universe, which we can see through various telescopes, and that's billion, billion, billion meters. Okay, billion is how many millions? 1,000 millions is a billion. It's actually roughly 10 crores. That number makes sense. Crores of rupees. We read about it in newspapers, though we never have them. Okay? So these are crores of meters. Many, many crores of meters. This visible universe has a galaxy cluster. The galaxy cluster has our own Milky Way. If you look up, this Milky Way, I will not still read the meters because they are huge number of meters. The Milky Way contains our solar system, and for the first time, the size of the solar system is 150 billion kilometers. That means 150,000 million kilometers. Million is 10 to the 6. And in this solar system, the Earth actually is now, we come to the numbers we know, 12,784 kilometers across. Okay, radius is half of that. Now, in this, on this Earth, you go to a sand field. In that sand field, let's take, this is a sand field with a radius of 1 meter. So from this Earth, you have come to 1 meter. From this 1 meter, take a grain of sand. Now, this grain of sand is about 0.5 millimeters. Millimeters, everybody can understand, no? So 0.5 millimeters of sand grain contains a silicon dioxide molecule, and that is how much? That is one number name you will all know, 1 nanometer. Nanometer, everybody knows, the nanotechnology. All right, so it's 1 nanometer. And this 1 nanometer contains an oxygen nucleus, now which is really small, which is a few Fermi. So nano was 10 to the minus 9 meters. Okay, now we are going down further. 6 orders of magnitude, 10 to the minus 15 meters is our oxygen nucleus. And from that oxygen nucleus, we have quarks, which, as I told you, are all we know is that they're smaller than 10 to the minus 18 meters. But if you ask a theorist like me, I will tell you they have no size. So now do you see from the universe how many orders of magnitude we have come inside? And the funny part is the laws of physics that I'm telling you work over this entire distance scale. Doesn't that fill you with wonder? And something like this that we can answer itself is such a heady feeling that this is what science is all about. Science is about understanding mysteries of nature and trying to digest everything, distill everything to a set of few concepts and to set of few equations. That is the purpose of one purpose of science. There are many other purposes, but this is one important aim of science, and this is what particle physics has done. So there are these fundamental constituents of matter, which are quarks and leptons, and we have a table here. The up-down quarks are the ones that we are familiar with. As I said, they make protons and neutrons. The remaining quarks, you know, actually, you can almost ask who ordered them. There was a very famous physicist called Rabi who said, who ordered this? What is meant by that is that there was no logical reason to understand why we should have replication of such fundamental particles. And if we were to explain only the world that we see around us, all we need is up, down quarks and electron. Actually, you also need the associated neutrino with the electron called electron neutrino, because when sun generates its energy, not only that it emits photons, which we see, of course, that's what every sunlight is about, but it also emits a large number of neutrinos. Okay? So the basic process by which the energy is generated in the world, the basic source of energy for all of us, at one time or the other, it may be a fossil fuel today, but someday it came from the sun. Okay? So the basic source of energy is there, and that basic reaction, energy generating reaction, generates new E. So for the world around us, we needed up, down, electron and neutrino. But in very high energy processes, we actually started finding copies of these guys. What is meant by copies? That their properties were very similar, but their masses were different. Mass is also one property. Okay? So what is the difference between an electron and a muon? A muon is somehow a heavier electron. As a matter of fact, Bhabha, how many people know the name of Bhabha? Homi J. Bhabha? So he actually gave it the name first time, heavy electron, because he saw evidence for this in the cosmic ray experiments about which you heard from Professor Vishwa. Okay? So this is, a muon is a heavier electron, and a tau lepton is yet heavier electron. All right. So these are the fundamental particles, and also their antimatter, which doesn't exist in the world around us, by the way. Because if antimatter existed, what would happen? We would all annihilate. So the fact that we live here without getting annihilated means that the world is made only of matter. But in nature, the antimatter does exist. Not only that, actually there was a very famous scientist called Dirac who actually predicted that based on demanding that the laws of nature should be the same in all frames of references. What does it mean? You do an experiment here, you do an experiment at a train moving extremely fast, and you calculate the measure the pendulum time, oscillation time, and determine the gravitational constant. Do people understand the gravitational acceleration g, a basic unit that everybody hopefully understands? So you do that experiment in a train, you do that experiment in a plane, you do that experiment here. If you do it correctly, you will always get the same answer for G, with small corrections if you did it at higher altitudes. This is what is meant by saying that the laws of nature do not depend on the state of motion of the body. I guess this is something you have learned. And imagine that just from this principle alone, the genius of Dirac was able to predict that antiparticles must exist. And today, we have complete evidence experimental evidence that not only these particles exist are the fundamental objects, their antiparticles and antiquarks and antileptons also exist. We have full proof of that. All right, so the basic fundamental units of building blocks are quarks and leptons plus antiquarks and antileptons. And I already told you about how conservation laws predicted existence of particles. When I said that an electron must have an antiparticle, this was the story of Dirac. On the other hand, there was another very interesting discovery, and since this is an INO week, I will spend a few minutes on that, and that is the postulate of neutrino. What happened was radioactivity is something that you people know. What happens in a radioactive decay? Anybody can tell me? Yes? Radioactivity, people have heard the word or no? Yes or no? No? Ah, I see. In 10th, you don't do radioactivity. You don't know alpha, beta, gamma radiation. You heard them, okay. So what happens is that nuclei just come and they disintegrate. Okay, cobalt radiation therapy, somewhere in the newspapers, at least you must have heard this. If not in your textbook. Somewhere you must have heard the word radioactivity. Come on, give me a break. You have never read word, you have never heard the word radioactivity in your life? All right. So what does radioactivity do? Radioactivity means that elements, nuclei, just disintegrate spontaneously. This is what Mr. Becquerel found. And that is what began the entire subject of nuclear and particle physics. Now, what happens here? Here, that you find that a neutron decays into a proton plus an electron. And what was interesting is that electron would have all sorts of energies. Now, that is a bit worrisome, right? Because there should be energy should be conserved. If a neutron decays into a proton and an electron, after you sum the mass of the proton and the mass energy of the electron, it should add to the mass of the neutron, but it doesn't. So what happens? And this is where, in a bid, desperate bid, Pauli, another great scientist, said that there must be a neutral particle. Since it's neutral, I cannot see it, because the only way we see a particle is by charge, by its path, by the way it moves, and it we can see that this is a particle. It moves in a Geiger counter, it gives a signal in a cloud chamber or whatever have you. It's the path of a charged particle in matter. So if the particle is neutral, it's not going to leave a path anywhere. It's not going to leave its trace. It's a ghost. And therefore, we don't see, and it carries energy like a thief. That was Pauli's idea, and it took actually a long time before that neutrino was actually found. But this is how people, based on conservation of energy, Pauli suggested this. That conservation of energy is a God-given principle. Energy should not come from somewhere, because if energy started coming from somewhere without being conserved, we will now have no energy crisis in the world, no? So energy cannot be created spontaneously, except in Harry Potter, right? All right? All right. So therefore, this is how we have. Then we have these four fundamental forces. I'm going to skip through this because I'm going too slow. So let me now come to the point that we have this picture. This is particle physics. There are these fundamental particles, and there are four fundamental forces. But where did the subject begin? The subject began in the birth of an electron. Now please humor me and tell me that you know the name of J.J. Thomson. Good. I'm very happy. So about 100 and, I don't know now, again close to 125 or 30 years ago, Thomson actually discovered an electron. Now what is meant by he discovered an electron? Found out. But what? How did he find out? Not just by thinking, sitting under an apple tree, right? He found it by something else. So what did he do? He took a cathode ray tube. Nothing more than that. What is a cathode ray tube? Not anymore TVs. In the old days, TVs used to be cathode ray tubes. So what you do is that you take, he was just heating this, that is what he was doing. He was looking at the what he calls cathode rays in a cathode ray tube, and these cathode ray tube accelerated the electron, which was emitted by the hot filament, because we agree, heat gives energy to the electrons, and the electrons get enough energy to jump out of the element, metal, and they start moving. And then the whole point was that from the property of the passage of these particles in the electrostatic field as well as the magnetic field, he was able to figure out that these are not protons. These are not hydrogen nuclei. How would he do that? He did that by looking that the mass of the particle, because if you let the particle travel in magnetic field and electrostatic field, which are crossed, actually you find the value of the mass to charge ratio. And that is where you found that the mass to charge ratio of this particle was very different from the only known particle at that time, which was hydrogen ion. So people say, ha-ha, we have a new particle. And this is how Thomson, in my opinion, actually split the atom, in some sense. Because that's what it was actually happening. Heat was splitting the atom. It was taking the electron out of that atom and leaving the ion behind. That's exactly what happened. And that's how the first fundamental particle was found. In this classic accelerator experiment, because what is the accelerator here? It's your cathode ray tube, and it's the potential difference. That's where you are seeing the particle being created. So the hot filament has created the electrons. The electrons have been accelerated through potential difference. So you have used this classic accelerator to find the first fundamental particle, which was called electron. Now, here I have given you a picture to show you the real size. This is more or less a tabletop experiment. So the first fundamental particle was found by a tabletop experiment, if you wish. Then came the second one, which again I heard, many of you have heard about this experiment, called Rutherford scattering experiment. Anybody has an idea how big this experiment was? It was in a room like this. And what did they have to do? There was a beam. What was the beam? The alpha particle source. The beam of alpha particles was coming out of the source. It's a natural accelerator. Alpha particles hit on this thin gold foil. Somebody told me this, so I'm now using it. And what was the detector? The detector was actually a little telescope. And what was the telescope detecting? Flashes of light that the alpha particle produced when it hit on a zinc sulfide screen. Simple enough experiment, and this is an experiment which could be done in a dark room, which is half the size of this room. All you needed was a scintillating material. Scintillation is a word everybody understands, hopefully. That some of times when charged particles hit on the surface of a scintillating material, light is produced. That is called scintillating. English word scintillating is understood by everybody. So scintillations are nothing but flashes of light. And the flashes of light are produced by the alpha particle hitting on this zinc sulfide screen. It doesn't happen on every screen. On this light, if an alpha particle hits here, it won't produce scintillations. So you have to have a scintillating material. So this is the detector. My God, this is the beam and this is the target. Let me try to come to the big size, hopefully, in the next few slides. Now what happens? Here I have to introduce a very important concept. People know about microscopes and telescopes, right? So what is the resolving power of a microscope? Anybody knows the word resolving power? Yes, no, maybe. Maybe I have heard the word resolving power somewhere. Doesn't look like that, huh? Resolving power word is not known. Then shall I explain it? At least say yes, no, we don't care. Tell me we don't care and I will stop at this point. Is that okay? Because I need some feedback from you. A microscope is not something you have used in the lab. You have used. So resolving power of a microscope is the ability to be able to see two points separately. That is, if you are looking at a cell, that there is a nucleus in the cell, some you would have done this for a cell of a leaf or something like that, or something or the other, where you see a nucleus and you see a separation. If resolving power is not enough, you will not see that separation. Now, what does resolving power depend on? The resolving power depends on what is the wavelength of the light that you have used. Why? Because light is wave that everybody at least hopefully understands. So now a wave goes like this. So if the distance between the two points that I'm looking at, that I can see as separate, should be the same as the wavelength, no? Because during one wavelength, light goes from a minimum to maximum and minimum again, right? It goes through one cycle, which means that if a distance is less than the wavelength of the light, I will see that as a point. Do you agree with that? Because I will not be able to distinguish between the intensity of light in this short distance. The intensity, I can see absence of intensity, and I can see presence of high intensity only when they're separated by a distance larger than one wavelength. Is that idea kind of acceptable? Which means that if I want to look at structures which are smaller and smaller, what will I have to do? I'll have to reduce the wavelength to smaller and smaller amounts. But visible light wavelength is fixed, no? That everybody hopefully knows. The wavelengths of visible light are within few thousand angstroms. Which means that using visible light and using a microscope, I cannot resolve structures that are smaller than a few thousand angstroms. Now I need to do something more. What do I do? This is where one Mr. de Broglie, actually I think he always remained Mr., came into picture, and he used Einstein's famous discovery. Einstein was actually the first person, I don't know how many of you know this, but Newton believed that light was made up of particles. Then came Mr. Huygens, and Huygens showed to everybody light is actually a wave. And you know, you do experiments, yellow line of sodium, you look at the diffraction, you look at the, use a prism, you see the pattern, so you know light is made up of wave, light is wave. Then Einstein came and said, no, light is a particle. And actually, photoelectric effect proved that light is a particle. So this was the 20th century's beginning of what we call the quantum revolution. And using this idea, de Broglie said, what is special about a photon? Why should a photon be able to be a wave and a particle simultaneously? An electron should also be able to do that. But everybody said, an electron, Thomson saw it traveling in a straight line and saw it subject to the magnetic fields. It is a particle. So what is happening? And de Broglie made this fantastic conceptual suggestion, which later on turned out to be true. And he used the fact that the wavelength and the frequency of light are inversely proportional to each other. I hope everybody knows that. H nu, C, lambda nu is equal to C. C is the velocity of light. So a wavelength of light lambda has a frequency nu, such that lambda times nu is C. So I know that E, the energy of a photon, is H, which is the Planck's constant, times nu, which means it's H C by lambda. So this was something that was known, and C is velocity of light. So in fact, what Mr. de Broglie said, I will use exactly the same idea, except that instead of the velocity of light, I will replace it by the velocity of the particle. And lambda times nu essentially is the velocity of light. I use that and I would be able to convert and say that the wavelength associated with a given particle is h upon 2 pi, but h is a very, very small constant. So if the momentum is very, very small, actually lambda is infinite. If it's infinite wavelength, what does it mean? Particle. It's a particle, there is no wave nature. I don't see any wave nature. Wavelength is infinite means amplitude is the same here and same there, even if I go all the way to the moon. If that happens, that means it's a particle. Okay? So that is what happened, that particles look like particles at low velocities, but when I increase the velocity and I increase the momentum, wavelengths start becoming smaller and smaller and smaller. So you can actually calculate what was the wavelength of the alpha particles that Rutherford used in his scattering experiment. You can ask that question and you can actually calculate using this formula. I have done that calculation in my slides a little bit further, but I can tell you the answer And that answer is that those alpha particles were of the order of million electron volts because they came from a nucleus. And I told you that the nuclear disintegration energy is with the order of million electron volts. And that corresponded to a distance scale of many, many, many angstroms. And that is why you saw the nucleus as a point particle and lot of empty space in between. I have two more slides which I must show. Otherwise, I won't make the point at all. So this was the point that the alpha particles, okay, they are order of energy MeV, and the wavelength is about 1 over 100th angstrom. And what did I tell you about the nucleus? How much smaller is the nucleus than an atom? Anybody remembers? Factor of what? 10,000? 10, 1, 5? Huh? Zero. I can't hear. 10 to the minus 18, but between a nucleus and an atom, when I'm asking. Okay, I showed you this here. I want to go back here. This picture I showed you, and I took some time on this, that this is the atom, and a nucleus is 10,000 times smaller than an atom. Atom is a few angstroms, and therefore a nucleus is a few Fermi. And a proton is 10 to the minus 15 meters, and 10 to the minus 18 meters is quarks. We are right now looking at atom and nucleus. The nucleus is 10,000 times smaller than an atom. Atom is a few angstroms, so nucleus is 10,000 times smaller than an angstrom. Okay. However, the wavelength of alpha particles, which I just told you about, is 100th of an angstrom. So 100th of an angstrom means that it is still 100 times, 1,000 times bigger than the size of the nucleus. So if the wavelength is 1,000 times bigger than the size of the nucleus, I'm not able to see that nucleus structure. I'm going to say nucleus is a point. So this is what is meant by resolving power. And this is what is meant by how, by using now particle beams of higher energy, we can do what pure light cannot do. That is what I tried to tell you. And this is this picture that I really wanted to reach. And I'm happy that I reach here. So what is this? I have written this as a meter stick. So if you want to see things that are very, very, very big, I told you galaxies which are billions and billions of meters. How do you see galaxies? You see them telescopes. Okay? And then there is one fantastic telescope we have, which is a radio telescope called GMRT, which is near Pune, okay, which is a giant meter wave radio telescope. That's again using different parts of the frequency, and using different frequencies, you can see structures of different sizes. So here we can see using this radio telescope, for example, galaxies. You can use the ordinary telescopes and see rings around Jupiter if you wish. I hope some of you have seen it sometime. Okay. Then if I want to just see a few meters across something, a dog, my eye can do it. I have that much resolving power. Then I can use a microscope to see a cell, which I was telling you about, where I use visible light. The visible light is a few thousand angstroms. So a few thousand angstroms visible light will not be able to see the nucleus and not be able to see even an atom, because atom is tens of angstroms. Wavelength is 1,000 angstroms. 1,000 angstrom over that distance scale, the atom is a point. But then I use alpha particles like Rutherford did, which have a wavelength of a few hundredth of an angstrom, and it was able to see that there is a nucleus, which is point. According to him, it was point. And actually, these things, before I go to the atom and the nucleus, nowadays we do a lot of physics and biology using what are called electron microscopes. So we use very high energy electrons. And actually, it is this electron microscope pictures which help, among other people, Rosalind Franklin, to tell us that the world, its basic unit, is a DNA. What DNA has been heard? Okay, very good. So DNA is an extremely small amount structure, but that structure you can see with an electron microscope of appropriate energy. Now you have understood. I can dial the energy and I can change the wavelength. Now, accelerators do exactly the same thing. They keep on increasing the energy. You keep on probing structures at shorter and shorter distances, because by decreasing the wavelength, you are increasing, if you wish, the resolving power of your microscope. And that's why particle physics is nothing but a high energy experiment. Now, how do I accelerate particles? There is a cosmic rays is one cosmic accelerator, but there is only one and only. And that experiment is done. It keeps on doing. I have no control over it. Particles come. It provided me with a lot of physics. It started the subject of particle physics. But what we need is controlled energy, because I want to turn knobs. And that is why accelerators were made. And initially, you found, how do you accelerate particles? Everybody will agree. I can accelerate them by putting them through a potential difference. That everybody understands? But now if I want the energy of 1 GeV, how much would be the potential difference? 1,000,000th. Let's forget about giga. I need a 1,000,000 potential difference. Huh? Can you imagine what will happen if I try to actually create a potential difference of 1,000,000,000? What will happen? Things will just start sparking, no? Even with high voltage, you have seen high voltage cables, no? So high voltage, things will just start sparking. And nothing will happen. Nothing useful can happen. So obviously, you cannot just increase the potential difference and accelerate particles. You have to do something smarter. And there was a very smart, intelligent gentleman, Wilson, who first decided that I don't need to accelerate particles only by applying potential difference. There is another interaction that is there, which I hope you all know, magnetic interaction. So you apply magnetic fields, and the particles keep on rotating in ever higher radius as their energy goes on increasing. The centrifugal force transfers the energy to the electron, and that is how, at Large Hadron Collider or any other earlier colliders, particles start getting accelerated in a circular ring with magnetic fields. So as you go on increasing the energy that you want to achieve, you go on increasing the size of your accelerator. Once you go on increasing the size of your accelerator, the detectors you want to make also need to be very big, because, for example, a muon, he told you how a particle is detected, but a muon, for example, doesn't radiate at all. So the only way I can measure the energy of a muon is when it curves in a magnetic field. Do you know these charged particles follow a curved path in a magnetic field? So by measuring the radius, I will be able to tell what is the energy of this muon. Because when I do experiments, I must be able to measure all the energies exactly. Then only I can draw my, I can try to check whether what I'm seeing is consistent with my theory. So for example, typically a muon is a very nice object which people detect. And this muon at high energy travels meters together without bending even in strong magnetic fields. So which tells me that my detectors at these high energy experiments also have to be huge. So then there are many other things that come. For example, a particle which, these particles don't exist around us. I told you, they exist, they are created for a fraction of a second. Fraction of a fraction of a fraction of a second. In fact, 10 to the minus 12 17 seconds. How do I measure that kind of a time slot? I need very accurate methods to measure such time scales. So the entire business of trying to probe physics here requires complex experiments, detectors. First, you need machines to accelerate the particles. Then you need detectors to make the measurements. And I would like to show you one picture. Yeah, this is what I told you about cosmic rays. This is what accelerators were. So the first accelerator was here, 4.5 inches. Just see, that's a tabletop. And it accelerated particles to 1,000 electron volts, which looks great. The first Van de Graaff generator, Cockcroft-Walton accelerator, which fitted inside a room. But today, on the other hand, we all know LHC is 27 kilometers long. So this tells you precisely the orders of magnitude by which we have had to increase the sizes of our experiment to probe physics at shorter and shorter distance scales. So this tells you the first and foremost point why we need big scales in doing these explorations. There are many other interesting stories that one can tell, but this is all the time that I have. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Godbole. That was an excellent introduction to the entire range of physics and the kind of instruments that are required to study the physics of the modern times. I'd just like to say a bit about Professor Godbole. She is often in committees that include Nobel Prize winners. And why am I saying this is just to impress upon you the earnestness with which we want you to get to know more about this kind of physics. And
can I just take the last slide which I had prepared? Which
sure.
Where I want to make an appeal to you guys. So let me see if I can. This was my appeal to you, that, you know, there are many, many questions here, okay? Questions are, there are lots of ununderstood mysteries. For example, what are the chemical properties of life on the earth that we have? How was matter created? How was life created? We don't understand this. Why does universe contain only matter and no antimatter? What is dark matter? We don't know. Or why are, for example, L-amino acids more common in biological systems? These are all many, many questions which we think will have answers in fundamental physics. And therefore, I hope that some of you guys someday will do something to answer these questions. That is the hope and the reason why we are trying to tell you things which are perhaps not quite acceptable to you, perhaps not quite understandable to you, because, you know, you always need to set your sights somewhere high to know where you have to go. All right? And I seriously hope that the science discoveries that are made in these mega projects, which you will see upstairs, and the technological developments that happen during their execution, both will be very helpful in for us, mankind, to answer these very fundamental questions which we want to answer just because. There is no other reason but to understand. And you know, somewhere or the other, finally, you do this blue sky research and suddenly there comes something which changes our lifestyle. And so what does it do for me? For example, people who invented semiconductors, which have now all the miniaturized devices, and all of you have your cell phones, people who did that didn't begin by saying that I want to invent semiconductors. They were looking at semiconductors as a curiosity. Or for example, everybody of you know World Wide Web. World Wide Web was invented at CERN by experimentalists only to exchange data. And now you know how much World Wide Web has changed the way we do life, the way our social life is conducted, the way our financial life is conducted. So never ask only the question, what is it good for? Many of these things, unknowingly, you know, I will tell you, end up with a very interesting story which is attributed to Michael Faraday. So Michael Faraday, when he invented the laws of Maxwell or Faraday, I forget, when he invented the four laws of electromagnetic field, how electromagnetic fields behave, so one of the guys, you know, who was the fund giver, he said, so what good is it? Somebody asked, no? What good are cosmic rays? And he said, I dare say, sir, someday you will tax it. And indeed, all the governments in the world tax the electromagnetic energy today. So thank you very much, and I hope you can do something worthwhile.
Thank you, Professor Rohini Godbole, for such a fired up zeal. And see, like I said, I mean, when she talks in the audience, there are most eminent scientists of the world sitting there listening to her. And now she is coming to you with such fired up zeal, trying to explain some of the most difficult concepts. So it shows that we are very earnest in wanting you to get the fire, get the imagination going, get excited about these so many unanswered questions. In fact, all these mega science projects are mega science because they take years to build. We are now only building it. And maybe 10 years, 15 years down the line, you or one of you may be the one of the principal scientists who will be working on that. And also these are mega engineering projects.
Exactly.
I mean, huge, massive, all branches of engineering are required to, in order to build this and get this going. So this is our main message to you people. You can go upstairs and listen to all the various exhibits that are showed there of all the various mega science project. In fact, she mentioned GMRT. There is one such thing there called square kilometer array.
Yeah.
It's the next generation of GMRT. You please go and look at it. I mean, these are all, if you look at the poster there, it shows how all these mega science projects are trying to come together to understand all the unanswered questions about the universe, right from this tiniest particle to the massive galaxies and the structures of galaxies. Yes, thank you very much. We come to the end of today's session. So thank you very much. Yeah. You have any questions?
Ma'am, I would like to ask, how did we come to know that we are in Milky Way galaxy, ma'am?
That's okay. See, this is something you have asked a good question. Because the point is, our first explorations started by looking outside. Because even Socrates, who was I hope you know his name.
Yes, ma'am.
He was the one who said that the only way we will learn something is by observing ourselves from outside or by observing the outside. So it took a long time, as you know very well, that we didn't even agree that we were not at the center of the world, right? That the sun, we were revolving around the sun. So all this basically really took time. And the measurements of the earlier, the people who made measurements and who actually came up with this realization that we are inside a whole conglomerate of galaxies, this work is due to Herschel. The Herschel was actually the king astronomer to the king of England. And what was even more interesting, that his sister, Caroline Herschel, is actually credited with discovering many galaxies and comets. So this is really the early astronomical observations which brought home to people that we are in the middle, in one corner of a big structure.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, what do we mean by thermonuclear fission, ma'am?
Ah, my God. I didn't know I talked about these things. All right. Thermonuclear fusion is... what do you mean by nuclear fusion? Do you know? Do you know what is meant by nuclear fusion at all? Do you know what is meant by nuclear fission? If you are going to ask me this question, I have the right to ask you one more first question. Explosives are fission? Are all explosive nuclear fissions? What is meant by nuclear fission? Because before you ask me thermonuclear fusion, let's understand whether we understand what is meant by nuclear fusion and nuclear fission. Okay, let me tell you this. See, the whole point, and this is something, I'm sorry to say this. If you don't know this in 10th, you should actually do some extracurricular reading. I must say this. This is not the duty of your teachers to teach you this. But these are the things that are nowadays becoming common knowledge. Nuclear energy. How does nuclear energy come about? Do you know that? Do you know how sun produces its energy? Sun produces it? No. It doesn't produce the energy by radiation. Light is emitted, but it is not produced from there. It is produced in a nuclear reaction. That nuclear reaction takes protons which fuse together and make a helium nucleus. And the energy of 4 protons separate is much more than the energy of a helium nucleus. And the fusion of these 4 protons together, how that happens? That's a nuclear reaction. And in that process, you emit photons. And those photons are the radiation. The reactions happen in the core of the sun. The photons try to come out. And afterwards, they come out. And that's how the radiation comes out. So that's the fusion. That's a fusion reaction. Now you want to achieve this fusion reaction on Earth, and that is what the big ITER project is all about. You yeah. try to create energy through fusion reactions. Now what you have to answer for yourself and understand is that why is it that fusion of nuclei emit energy?
So you're...
That is something yeah. I give you as an exercise. Yeah. To you can do it in 2 minutes by going to Google. Doesn't require longer than that.
Have you visited the exhibition upstairs?
Please look at ITER.
There is an exhibition.
Look at ITER yeah. Exhibit so and you will hear a lot.
There is in fact, there is a model that will explain all this to you.
Yeah. 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 Now what happens is that what you find is that all the amino that is the point actually, that in biological systems, what you find is that it is much more often to have amino acids which have which cause, for example, if they interact with light, they polarize the light. So they actually have a automatic direction associated in the amino acid itself. There is a directionality. And that directionality appears in its interaction with light. And that is why they are, and why this happens, we don't know.
But amino acids are the building blocks of our
body. That is right.
So it has a lot of relation to our...
Exactly, but we don't know why this happens. So there are sugars, okay? There are certain, most of the sugars that you have, sugar solutions, which polarize the light when it goes through, they always polarize it in the left. They never produce right polarized light. And we don't know why. And this has to do with their chemical structure. And why this chemical structure is more stable than another, the right-handed chemical structure, chemists have not been able to calculate and prove it. So that's why I put that. That's actually a problem. Meaning, it's a mystery. Right now, it's a mystery. And we would like to understand. And believe it or not, the experiments that have been done, and believe it or not, all these mega, you know, some of these experiments in high energy physics might actually have an answer to it. That is the reason for putting that problem here.